See, if you look at my background, I come from an organization which always believed in leadership. Infosys was founded by 7 people. Interestingly enough, when I look around, there aren't that many organizations where the founders have stayed for such a long time. The founders who started Infosys in 81, they left in 2014, so almost 35, 36 years later. On the way, we set up the Mysore Institute of Leadership, Infosys Institute of Leadership in Mysore. That happened in probably 2002. So I come from an organization which strongly believes that you need very good leadership to make any kind of transformational journey. Right, any organization, Infosys is a good example of an organization which transformed multiple times over its lifetime. Right, between 81 and 2014, Infosys changed and transformed itself multiple times for various reasons, whether it is demand from the customer, change of the market, change of the technology, all of those reasons. Now, when I look at education, we are all clear. We are all here for one reason only, that we are all convinced that education needs to change. Right, it needs to change. It needs to, quality of education has to improve. We have done a good job of quantity of education, but quality of education deserves a lot. Pedagogical changes has to happen. If you look at the national education policy, which got rolled out, the FLN has to happen. The foundational learning has to happen. If you look at any of the numbers, I have seen reports which says that the fifth grade children can't even read first grade textbooks. So that means this is a field which requires change. And change has to be led, done from the front. It has to be driven by leaders. Leaders who believe in these kinds of things. Leaders who believe in change. Leaders who believe in improving the system. Leaders who can observe, who can make sense of the requirements, who can implement, who can monitor, who can measure the impact and go back to, doing more of it. That means creating a virtuous cycle of improvement, and that requires very, very strong leadership. These are people who believe in the cause, who believe that the system has to change, who do not take no for an answer. I think, when I look at the leader, the first thing I see is whether he's willing to take no for an answer. If he's willing to take no for an answer, then I think I call him a manager. But if you're a leader, this is a person who will not take no for an answer. And many of these changes which we need to make, many of these transformations which we want to achieve are extremely difficult. Because it's a very complex, very large, very dispersed, very decentralized, very contextual system, right? Which means many of these changes which we need to make, whether it is improving the foundational learning, whether it is improving the quality of learning, it requires an enormous amount of drive, enormous amount of passion, enormous amount of commitment. That is why I strongly believe that leadership is a must for this transformation. In a very large system like education in this country, the leadership is even more important. As I said, we have 1.5 million schools, 200 million children in the school, 200 million. The US population is 350 million people. Just compare yourself with something. The US population is 350 million people, and we have 200 million people in the school system. We have 4.5 million leaders in the system with 10 million teachers. We have something like 850 universities, so our system is very, very, very large, very vast. And we face serious shortages at every level. The last time I looked, we are short of approximately 9 lakh qualified teachers. Right, we are in shortage of 9 lakh qualified teachers. This was a report, I think, which came from Teach for India. So there is severe deficit of people at all levels. And when I look at leadership, I am not talking about a certain segment of people. It is not about principals. It's not. It is the whole ecosystem of people, right? For example, we need enlightened parents who can demand quality of education. You need principals who can actually drive change within the school system. We need societal leaders like you who can actually participate in this transformation and make it more contextualized, right? So we are talking about a gamut of people required and leadership required at each of these levels. So in the recent years, what has happened is that there has been a lot of talk about teachers training, which is absolutely right, rightly so. Because at the end of the day, the teaching is a contact sport. That means the student and teacher, they're in the same room or in the same, now in the same chat, same video, but it's a contact sport, which means that the teacher makes a lot of difference to the student's ability to learn, ability to absorb, and ability to remain curious. So, of course, it makes sense to put in a lot of effort in improving the quality of teachers. But at the same time, the improvement of the system, not of a classroom, we are not talking about improving a classroom, we are talking about improving a system, improving the whole, different parts of the system, right? Whether it is pedagogical, whether it is behavioral, whether it is various other facets of running a school, or running an educational institution, then we have to make sure that the leader is equipped. And the leader is equipped to, observe, plan, solve, learn, and connect. Right? The leader is equipped to do all of these things and creates this cycle of improvement. Right? Any improvement is a journey. That means you need to create a cycle of improvement to go to the next level of the next level and the next level. So I clearly believe that with all these changes which are going to happen, with the national education policy, with the focus on foundational learning, and the scale of our system, right? And more importantly, the need for transformation, the need for education, need for quality education. I think leadership is extremely important in our education system today. Conflict between important and immediate, right? So because we have so many challenges in the education system, right? So when you look at it, the first thing which comes to mind is the teacher, right? But after all, he or she is the person who is actually interacting with the student. So it is natural that we have this focus on the teachers, and I think I feel very glad that over the last many years we have actually made it a national narrative. But at the same time, teachers alone cannot solve the problems. I'm very convinced, as you are, that teachers alone cannot solve our big problems in the education system. A teacher or a large number of teachers can make a difference in their classroom, but to transform a system, a teacher alone will not be able to do it, right? So we need excellent school principals, right, to support these teachers. The same teachers whom we are training, they really need support. They need conviction. They need to be told again and again that this is what we need to do. You are doing a good job. So you need excellent principals who can actually keep the passion alive within the same set of teachers whom we are training. We need informed parents who will stay engaged with the teaching learning process of the schools, because if the parent is not involved, especially in today's world with this online classes, the parents need to be even more involved. But even otherwise, you need informed parents who will stay engaged with the schools. You need bureaucrats and the politicians who have the vision to think about the long-term plans in education, right? They need to create an environment which will enable the principals and teachers to perform better and better and better. So you need people in bureaucracy and in politics who are actually visionaries, who can think 20 years later, 50 years later, how the system will transform. And you need civil society leaders like you, who will be the, who will keep all these people accountable and honest to some extent, to themselves and to the society. So you need an entire ecosystem of leadership. So when we talk about leadership, I don't think we should focus only on one aspect of leadership or one set of people. We should talk about the need for leadership on all these levels, including corporate leaders who need to come forward to mobilize the necessary resources required for us to support our school system. So I think it's important for us to create a national narrative, and I see that happening actually, because while it has taken us a while, so if you look at, for example, the Shiksha Logam functionalities are now available in Diksha, and that is under a banner called Leader. So the leadership is starting to slowly gain momentum. The narrative of leadership is starting to gain momentum, and I'm absolutely convinced that the more and more people like you believing in leadership, the need for leadership, that will create a national narrative. Of our education is diversity, right? It is enormously diverse. If you look at a country like ours, you have one end to the other. There are multiple systems, multiple priorities, multiple cultures, multiple issues. And it is impossible to create a solution which will work across the country. It is impossible to think about a solution which will work across the country in a uniform manner. Contextualization, localization can be only done by people who are in that community, who understand the problems of that community, who can actually take a solution, even if it is created centrally, but apply it locally, right? Making sure that it is applied locally. And of course, you always have this resistance to not invent it here centrally. That is another problem which you face, right? Because nobody wants to use anything which is not invented here, because it doesn't work in my environment, it doesn't work in my school system. So that is the second most important role. While you are actually creating contextualized solutions, it is not about reinventing everything. It is about, I think, taking what has been done in other parts of the country. So in many ways, you are not only a local player, you need to act as a global player, because you are the conduit, you are the network through which the learnings have to move around, but get contextualized. So the role is multifold, right? You have to amplify the impact of something which is being done. You have to contextualize it locally, and the acceptance of something which is coming from a local community leader is much higher than coming from anywhere else. At the same time, do not create the approach of, you know, not invented here syndrome, so that you can actually, you are a conduit for the global knowledge, global solutions which can be leveraged and accepted locally because of your participation. So multiple things. I'm a big supporter of innovation, but more importantly, I'm a big supporter of execution, because I'm a person who believes that ideas are dime a dozen. Finally, the value gets created only when you execute. So it's very, very important to make sure that innovation, ideas, all of those are, you know, in a country like ours, probably 10 to 15% of our work, and the remaining 85% has to be execution, right? And in fact, while I was at Infosys, I used to say that in a country like India, even if you can execute something which has been done outside, better than what it has been done outside, it is even, you know, it is best. In the sense, there is nothing in copying an idea, but we have to execute it properly. Just the idea copying doesn't really help. So going back to innovation, I think one of the challenges which we have in our school system is we don't encourage creativity. So whenever I look around for innovation, and there is a definite shift in the last few years with the startup ecosystem and all that becoming much more prevalent and accepted. But before that, if you look at innovation, entrepreneurship, all that was really not socially accepted words in my mind. But I think all that is changing now. So innovation requires creative thinking. It requires identifying areas where you can make a difference. One thing I think about when I do innovation is, what is the level of multiple which I can create? In my mind, an idea is worth, and I come from the business world, right? Because in my terms of business, if you can reduce the cost by 100, if you can increase the speed by 100, or you can increase the quality by 100, not 100, 100 times, right? So quality or time should get multiple, you know, will become, quality should go up by 100 times, time should come down or cost should come down, because that is what innovation is at the end of the day. So if you look at the education system, so how do we make sure that these transformations happen at a speed which is almost unimaginable, right? Today, when you look at a transformation, if we are taking 3 years to roll out something across the state, the question is, can we actually do it in 3 months? And what will that take? What kind of innovation will that take? What kind of creativity will that take? What kind of systems will that take? Can we do it at a cost? Because, you know, we are trying to do 101.5 million schools, right? How can we reduce the cost per school? For example, you know, how can you do it much affordable manner, right? Things like that. So I come from a world of business metrics for innovation, but I think all of that applies even in your world. Whenever you think about innovation, think of these three things. That is my mind. And everything can be measured. If you are doing some innovation which cannot be measured, I suggest you leave it behind. Right? The question you need to ask is, can you reduce the time by 100 times? Can you reduce the cost by 100 times? Can you increase the quality by 100 times? Right? So when you talk about teaching, can you increase the quality by 100 times? If you aim for 100 times, you will at least make 10. Right? But you have to aim for 100 times. So it's very important to make sure that when you look at innovation, when you think about innovation, when you think about doing something, you are able to measure the impact. And in my mind, innovation, you can measure in multiple ways, but the best measurement are the three things which I just told. I used to work for an organization called Sun Microsystems. It was many, many years back. And the first thing they told me when I joined Sun was that consensus is not a way to run an organization. It is a little extreme statement. Consensus is not a way to run an organization. This was Sun's philosophy and it was a $5 billion corporation. It was not a small company. They always believed that consensus was not a way to run an organization. To some extent, I also believe in that. At the end of the day, every team, every organization need leaders at various levels. Leadership is not one person in the system. Leadership is at all levels in the system, right? And you can have all the conversations which you want to have. You can have all the ideas on the table, right? And most often in places where there are more brilliant people, it's very difficult to come to a consensus, because everyone is actually very passionate, everyone is extremely knowledgeable, everyone is extremely intelligent. very difficult to come to a consensus. So at that point in time, it is the leader's job to take the final call. Right? The final call has to be made by the leader. Decision making is a very, very, very big part of leader's job, leader's responsibility. And most often the leader has to take the decision without having 100% of the information. You will never, ever have more than, at best, 80%. But you will never, ever have more than 80%. But the leader has to take a decision. And it is the team's responsibility to follow through. Once the decision is made, all the differences which you had before, all the discussions which you had before the decision was made, is passed. Right? And once it is done, the team has to pull together and move forward. And it is very important, whether you are a social enterprise, whether you are a business enterprise, whether you are a CSO, it doesn't matter. The principles of running an organization, the principles of managing a team are no different. Right? Absolutely no different at all. We actually, very honestly, so of course some of you know that I run schools, Kumari run schools, I do Kumari run schools. We have hesitated to have too many volunteers. And the reason being, at least occasionally we have come across people who think volunteering is God's work and I will do it whenever I want, however I want. And we find it extremely hard being an organization which is very disciplined and very accountable. So it doesn't matter whether you are a social enterprise, whether it is a public enterprise, whether it is a private enterprise, you are in education, you are in software, it doesn't matter. The principles of organizations remain the same. So you need to give opportunity for everyone to voice their opinions in a respectful manner. At the end of the day, a decision has to be made. If a collective decision is not made, it is the leader's decision to make that decision. Leader's decision will stand, and once the decision is made, it is the team's responsibility to get it executed. And that sense of accountability has to be there. If it is not there, then you have a problem with that. So, and many of you, I understand how you struggle with this, because many of you come together for a social cause because of passion. Many of you are sometimes of the same age, have been friends before. But once you are in the room, all the history and all the other factors have to be out. And the organizational principles have to take precedence. The points I made. So it's very, very important that each team takes accountability and responsibility for the decisions which are made by the team or by the leader after a due process, but in a very reasonable time. I always believe that taking any decision is better than a no decision. Any decision which you make, right or wrong, doesn't matter, because only time can tell you, is better than having a no decision. So a decision has to be made, and the team has to be held accountable to do it. So my aspiration always has been pretty clear, to make sure that education leadership becomes a national topic. Because when we started this journey in 2012, leadership, as you rightly said, most people had not seen the need for leadership in education as a fundamental requirement. Over the years, I think the journey has been very good. Today we have all of you here actually discussing how to make it a national topic. So my aspiration always has been to make sure that education leadership becomes a national topic and it gets its due importance, due place in the national conversations. I am very glad that we are here, and I am very confident that in the next 5 years it will take a central stage. There are many, many reasons. Number one, all of you are here. I think that is one of the most important reasons, because it's a collective effort, and it is with all your efforts, and the people who have been here before, and the people who will be here tomorrow, I think we will make sure that it becomes a national topic of importance in the field of education. That is one, and I think the impact of that will be felt over many, many years to come, over generations to come. My advice to all of you is to walk the talk. So when you talk about education leadership, when you talk about need for education leadership, the leaders who are in this call need to walk that talk. You have to be the leaders. You cannot expect the world to change if we are not willing to change. So make sure that everything which you do, every aspect which you take up, every time you interact with people in the system, you show your leadership. One of the very interesting, one of the most simplest thing I consider as leadership is to be on time. Right? One would say it's such a mundane thing, but please try it. If some of you just try it, be on time 10 times, then everyone else will be on time. I have seen this happen all throughout my life. I just have to be on time. 3 times after, everyone else will be there before me. So leadership is actually in doing things which you believe in and leading by example. So 2 things. I am extremely optimistic. I am 100% sure that educational leadership will take a central stage in the national debate with all your participation. My ask for all of you is to be leaders. You cannot ask for others to be leaders if we are not willing to be leaders. And leadership is in everything which we do. It is not about the big things or the small things. Actually, the small things are even more difficult to do. So if you do the small things, the big things will automatically follow. It's a great pleasure for me to launch the initiative. As we just discussed, I think innovation is a must. For us to improve, for us to create new ideas, new ways of doing things, new methods, new practices. So I think innovation is a must for us. Given our limited resources, it is very important for us to collaborate, co-create, share, and leverage each other's expertise and creativity. So it is with that in mind, I'm sure that Shiksha Logam is creating this marketplace for ideas, right? And related to education leadership. It will also build awareness. It will also build accessibility to ideas and creativity across the country. So I think there are many other facets which could emerge. Many other benefits which could emerge from such an initiative. It gives access to learning as well as mentorship opportunities. It will also, I think it is important to spotlight innovators and leaders, because you need role models. That is why you have awards and recognitions and things like that, right? Because the youngsters and new people will look at role models to feel confident, to emulate, to follow. So I think this will also create role models. It will put spotlight on innovations. So in many ways, I think this is a great initiative. I wish all of you all the best. And I also congratulate Shiksha Lokam for launching it. And congratulations on getting to 4 years.